Hey, space friends, this week I'm talking about colors made from creepy crawlers. Weird stuff, as you can always expect from me. I, as many of you know, went to art school, and as part of going to art school, I was in classes for color theory, which is all about the interaction of color and how color really affects perception and how perception changes how we view color, all of that stuff. If you're interested in a book about color theory, I recommend The Interaction of Color by Joseph Albers. I was at home reading an article about color that I found really fascinating. And I was reading through it, and one sentence caught my eye. It said, "For most of our history, dyestuffs have been derived from natural things such as plants, minerals, and invertebrates." I stopped at the word invertebrates because that sounded weird and creepy. It turns out it is weird and creepy. I knew about walnuts and saffron, but I didn't know about invertebrates as being used for dyes. So I started looking into it and digging around and discovered that royal purple, also known as Tyrian purple, also known as shellfish purple, is made of sea snails, specifically the mucus secretion of sea snails. Thousands of them. Royal purple used to be highly prized because it would take tens of thousands of sea snails being milked. By milk, they mean poking them so that they secrete this mucus so that they can then use that in a dye, or by just simply crushing them all to death. It took thousands and thousands of sea snails just to make a really tiny amount of purple dye. And so that's why it became royal purple, because it was really difficult to make, not easy to make, and thus people wanted it a lot, and it was kind of deemed only for royalty for a period of time. If you've heard of royal blue in addition to royal purple, turns out that's also made using sea snail mucus. The more you know. Okay, but that was during olden days and olden times. They were doing all sorts of creepy, weird stuff back then, right? Well, here's some more modern versions of invertebrates being used in dyes, some that you may have heard of. There are little insect bugs called lac, and lac produce secretions on trees. So they're on trees, they make their little gross little secretions, and then that secretion is actually used as a dye or resin in cosmetics, food, many different things, but most notably, and something you might be familiar with, varnish. So these little insects are called lac. Well, perhaps you've heard of lacquer or shellac. That comes from these gross little bugs. I'm sorry, maybe they're delightful little bugs, but these little bugs have these secretions on trees, and then that gets used in shellac and lacquer and so many other things in modern times. Another modern day example that you might be familiar with are cochineal bugs. Cochineal bugs are these flat bugs that are parasites on cacti. Well, if you take all of the female cochineal bugs and you dry them out and then you pulverize their corpses and mix them with salt, you can actually produce red dye. This red dye gets to be used on cosmetics and food, things like Jell-O, other types of food that you might not even suspect use cochineal bugs as red dye. They do. Lots of foods actually do. And they also get used to stain biological tissues in scientific labs so that you can better see human tissues, animal tissues, and other things like that show up under a microscope. Before the use of cochineal bugs, there was the use of Kermes bugs. And like cochineal bugs, with Kermes bugs, you could take the female bugs, mash up their dried bodies, and produce a red dye with them. Kermes actually comes from the Arabic word for crimson. So this dye was pretty famous in its day, and we have a modern day version in cochineal bugs. Another one you might be familiar with in modern times is sepia, that sort of brownish tone. Sepia comes from the Greek word for cuttlefish because sepia comes from the ink sacs of Sepia cuttlefish, a certain genus of cuttlefish. And so we actually use the ink sacs of cuttlefish to create sepia for ink on pens or also for squid ink pasta, even though it's technically cuttlefish ink pasta. Finally, as I was searching for all of the different invertebrate dyes that exist out there, I came across a modern day patent that was using sea cucumbers, specifically the ovary area of sea cucumbers, to produce a fluorescent dye. Really fascinating stuff. I had no idea that there was all this use of creepy awesome sea slime and insects to create all these different dyes and resins and things that we've used over the centuries and even in modern day times. It's really fascinating what people have been able to produce. But that said, you have to sort of be compassionate about all of these different animals that are being exploited for use of dyes. Ideally, we shouldn't be seeking out new ways to exploit animals to create these dyes, but it is fascinating what people have been able to discover over the years and how that can maybe translate into synthetic modern dyes that are inspired by things that originally came from biological specimens. Okay, that's it for me this week, Space Friends. As always, in the YouTube description, there are both relevant links to each topic I'm talking about every week, and also there's a shout out to the really awesome patrons that are helping support videos like this one. If you want to become a really awesome patron and help support videos like this one, I definitely appreciate it. I'm a team of one, and your help is really great. So you can head on over to my Patreon campaign and check that out if you're interested. Otherwise, I'll see you next week.